has been summer, they grieve us no more. The war has been won, I belong to the land of the rising sun. I belong to you, I belong to the land of the rising sun. The grieve us no more. The war has been won, I belong to the land of the rising sun. I belong to you, I belong to you. You know my pain and my failing and my doubting. I belong in the fire and the darkness, in the sadness. I belong just to everyone beside a fire. So I'm laying down these arms. The sun is rising. I belong to the land of the rising sun, where the grave is no more. The war has been won. I belong to the land of the rising sun. I belong to you.
I tell myself, keep walking on. Hear something up ahead, water falling like a song. An everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. Dry. I've rambled on my own, never believing I would find an everlasting stream. Your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. In the heavens, come live in one. All my fountains are in you. You're strong like a river. Your love is running through all my fountains are in you. Come on and rain down on us, rain down on us, Lord. Come on and rain down on us, rain down on us, Lord. We pray. Come on and rain down on us, rain down on us, Lord. In the heaven, come live in water, all my fountains are in you.
I think they have some motions for y'all to do this song, yeah?
Miracles are hard to believe in, but you're God, you're God. In spite of all my doubting, you show up, show up. I will rely on you, for you give me strength. Miracles are hard to believe in, but you got, you got. You got, you got. You got, you got. Come on, let it work your miracles. I'm looking for a breakthrough. Tear down the walls. I'm looking for a breakthrough. I'm looking for a page. You give me strength. The mountain didn't feel like moving, but you're God, you're God. Come on, let me work your miracles. I'm looking for tear down my walls of unbelief. I'm looking for a breakthrough.
When you split the Red Sea open, when you made the world fall, when you rolled the stone out the tomb away, you were working the impossible. When you split the Red Sea open, when you made the world fall, when you rolled the stone out the tomb away, you were working the impossible. Come on, let me work your miracles. I'm looking for a breakthrough. Tear down my walls of unbelief. I'm looking for a breakthrough. Come on, let me work your miracles. I'm looking for a breakthrough. Tear down my walls of unbelief. I'm looking for a breakthrough.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Let everything
that has breath
praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I'll praise in the valley and praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm short and praise when I'm down.
praise when I'm numbered. You praise when surrounded. His praise is the Lord. My enemies have you.
Y'all ready?
As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. And I'll praise when I feel it, and I'll praise when I don't. I'll praise because I know you're still in control. My praise is a weapon, it's more than sound. Oh, my praise is that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. Oh, so I'm gonna. Well, I won't be quiet. I'll praise 'cause you saw me, praise 'cause you reign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise 'cause you're faithful. Praise 'cause you. Praise 'cause there's nobody greater than me. I praise 'cause you saw. Praise 'cause you reign. Praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise 'cause you're faithful. Praise 'cause you're true. Praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you.
Y'all, this is already great, and I don't know about how y'all are doing, but we had a great time at the beach. Yeah? Boys, who won football? I know y'all played. Who won? Was it James's team? Did James cheat? Who won? Red team? Red team won? Boys, girls, what'd y'all do? Did y'all relax, y'all tan? Yeah? Yeah? Oh, there's a group of girls, and I'm going to do this for Ethan as well. What's up, brothers? That's awesome.
Sometime in our lives, we all have pain.
We all have.
Come on.
Babe, if we are wise, we know that babe, always tomorrow. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride if I have things you need to borrow, for no one can feel yet those of your needs that you won't let it show. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. So just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. Just might have a problem that you don't understand. We all need somebody to lean on again. So just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. Come on. We all. Come on. I just might have a problem that you'd understand. We all need somebody to lean on me. When you're not strong, I'll be your friend. I'll help you.
Cuatro.
It won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on, somebody to lean on, somebody to lean on.
Amen. Be seated, be seated, be seated. Have a sit down right there, have a sit down right there, right there, right there, right there, right there, right there. And make some noise for our speaker, Anna. Anna, Anna, yeah.
You guys are so funny. Thank you, guys. Let's hear it one more time for Abraham. You're so lucky to have him with us here. All right, so everybody had a good time at the lake today? Nice, nice, very exciting, I did too, got to light, whoa, that is defo not the light that's usually on my face, if that was the light that was usually on my face,
that's
I'd be so blind,
that is a light of the Lord right there,
that is really, really bright, bro,
so is Jesus,
oh, now I can't see anyone, all right, good, I'm glad you guys had a great day today, yeah, all right, I'm going to, anyone was swimming in the lake today? All right, good, good. I was too, I was too. Let's see, what else do we do today? Guys, got to hear, boys, you got to hear a great talk from James and Father Etienne. How was that? All right, good, good. Girls, you got to hear from our lovely Miss Jenny Doolittle. And how was that? All right, I thought so too, I thought so too. Good, well, I'm glad. Well, there's a couple other really important things that happened today. One really important thing that happened today was we didn't come in here at the beginning of the day. We didn't get to tell everyone so we could celebrate. But it happens to be someone here's birthday. Ike. Ike, where are you? There he is. Landon, you got that birthday song queued up? All right, let's hit it.
Happy birthday to you.
Ike, how many years young are you today? 12. 12, all right. Happy birthday, Ike. You're going to get something free tonight in the camp store for your birthday. I don't know, you pick. It's a gift for you. Okay, great. Happy birthday. Thank you for spending it with us. I appreciate you. All right, let's give it a break. All right, we have one more important thing. Now, I know that in the morning is usually when we do our teapot dance. We're going to actually save it for tomorrow morning for everyone else's stuff. But we do have one very important person that we need to come up here and do a teapot dance. Because it happens to be one of our staff members. I've got a phone here. It's got a black case, a black OtterBox case on the phone. Oh, look who it is! Oh, James, that's so embarrassing. Oh, I can't believe it. You're going to need to come up here and dance for it if you want it. Jenny, all right. Landon, got it?
Okay, everybody. Put one hand on your hip like an angel.
And I'm going to take this one solo. I think you know how it goes. Spout.
Are you ready, little teapot? I'm a little teapot, short and stout. Here is my handle, here is my spout. When I get all steamed up, hear me shout. Tip me over and pour me out.
That was good. Great job. Oh, I didn't steal it. You lost it. I think we need to be clear here. I don't know what teapot you've ever seen that looks like this. But that was... Bye, James. Thank you, James. Love you, James. All right. Oh, all right. Well, that was funny. All right. Yeah, right. All right. We're going to get started with a prayer if all of you would like to join me. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and enkindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. Saint Dominic Savio. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, so after prayer... And I don't know how we can tap such a great teapot dance. We do have a pretty good joke today for our Catholic meme of the day. So this one's got Mr. Krabs in it. And it says, when you're walking back from communion and you forget which pew you're sitting in. Because you just walk into a random one. Then the people in front of you are behind you, and you just don't know where you're going. Oh, it's so funny. Oh, kids, this is a real knee slapper. Thank you, thank you. All right, whew. I don't know if I can catch my breath after that funny joke, but I'll try and push on. Put on my headset now that I've flipped my hair around a little bit. All righty, and we're going to go into our scripture quote for today. This quote comes from John 10:10 and is actually our scripture quote that really encompasses the whole of this year at Camp Savio. It's the quote that's on the back of our Alive shirts that you just saw yesterday. And it's from John 10:10 and it says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." So that's John 10, verse 10. So, Monday, we talked about how, you know, how we ought to be in wonder and in awe of our God. And then yesterday, we talked about how we need to be thankful for all of the blessings that he's given us, right? So we have wonder and awe and thanksgiving. Today, the word of the day is receive. So it's a really, really special and important day because this is really like the heart of, I think, the calling of the Christian is to receive. When I was looking up and I was preparing for this talk tonight, I tried to just find like quotes from the Bible that had the word receive in it. And there was too many. There's a lot of times that our Lord is telling us to receive goodness, to receive from him, right? So I think it's one of the most important callings of the Christian is to receive. This ties in really well with what we talked about yesterday and really sets us up for success for the rest of the week. So can we go to the next slide, please? So what does it mean if we're called to receive? What are the things that our Lord wants us to receive? If he talks about it so much in Scripture, what are the things that he wants us to receive? So first thing you need to know about anything that you're going to receive is that it's a gift. If you're going to receive something, it's something that was given to you. Again, this ties directly back into what we talked about yesterday of how everything that the Lord does and gives to us is a gift, right? The good times, the bad times, everything is a gift. And our Lord wants us to receive that and receive it well. And receiving things is not just as easy as being like, well, that thing happened to me. There you go, right? There's something active that we also have to do. Receive is an action word, right? It's a verb. It means we're doing something when we receive or when we receive well. But ultimately, everything that we receive is a gift. It is freely given. It's like we talked about yesterday, being grateful for all that we've been given, good or bad, right? So it's free. We didn't earn it. We didn't deserve it, but it's a gift and it's for us. So our Lord calls us to receive the gifts that he is calling us to have. So go to the next slide, please. Whoa, this corn just attacked my front of my face somehow. Anyway, sorry. So how do we receive from the Lord? So we know what we're trying to receive. It's the gifts. It's whatever he wants to give us, right? The things in our lives. In Matthew, so in another gospel, we read in 7 verse 7, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened to you. So it's pretty easy, I think, sometimes for us to kind of have this mentality when it comes to God that, well, if he really wanted me to know something or he really wanted me to have something, he would just give it to me, right? Like, I could stand up here and be like, you know what? If God really wanted me to be a saint and he wanted all of you to believe it, he would make me levitate and lasers shoot out my eyes and stars come out of my fingers, right? He'd let me pray a million rosaries in a day, right? If he really wanted me to be holy, he'd just give me all that stuff, right? He'd just give me holiness if he really, really wanted me to be holy. And we can take this very passive approach to prayer. We can look at our prayer lives and be like, well, why do I have to ask anything about God? He already knows everything. He knows what I want. And if he really wanted to talk to me or if he really wanted to give me something, he'd just do it. But that's not what our Lord tells us. He says, ask and you shall receive. Because our Lord doesn't just want to be, like I kind of talked about a little bit on Monday, he's not just a vending machine or a genie. He's a loving Father. He loves you and wants a relationship with you. One of my big mentors in my faith life told me when I was about your age, and I've never forgotten it, he told me the phrase, Jesus is a gentleman. He doesn't storm into your heart and kick down the door and say, here, take this thing, or here, care about me, right? Our Lord actually waits for you to invite him in to your heart. He wants you to ask him to come and be. And the gifts that he wants to give you, he wants you to ask for them. He wants to know why you want these gifts. He wants to hear you say with your own words the desires of your own heart. Because he wants to know and care and love and give gifts to you. So one practice that I actually started way back when I was getting confirmed was when I remember to, I try and really intentionally pray for certain gifts of the Holy Spirit. Some of you are close to confirmation time, yeah? Or been confirmed? Who's either been confirmed or is about to get confirmed? Okay, cool, cool, cool. Okay, confirmation is one of my favorite sacraments. If you ever want to talk about confirmation, I will literally do it anytime, anywhere, any place. I love confirmation. But one of the coolest things about confirmation is you receive all of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So one thing that I really started trying to do ever since I received my confirmation when I was in eighth grade was when I remember to, I'll try and pick one gift of the Holy Spirit to ask for specifically. I'll be like, Lord, I really would like you to increase in me your gift of faith or your gift of fortitude. Faith is it. I meant to say knowledge. Your gift of knowledge, your gift of fortitude, your gift of piety. And even if you're not confirmed, you can already start doing this. You can ask the Lord to be like, Lord, help to make me more patient. Help to make me more loving. Help to make me more kind. Because it also helps you to understand where your heart is. And the ways that you need to increase in virtue. Because if all of us were honest with ourselves, we all know that there are things in our lives and ways in our lives that we need to improve and things that we need to give over to him and gifts that we need him for so that we can be saints. So we can't be passive about holiness. We can't be passive about what we want from our Lord. He asks us to ask him. Go to him. Receive. But it's active. It's doing something. It's asking for what he wants to give you. You can go to the next slide, please. All right. This word seems more complicated than it is, but I put a definition up in case it was confusing. But I think that, like I said, one of the greatest callings of all Christians is receptivity, which is just a word that means the ability to receive, right? Ability or willingness or quickness to receive or accept ideas, requests, experiences, etc. Readiness of something to receive something else. So one example of this is clay, right? You know the story of God being called the potter and we are the clay, right? That whole story is meant to talk to us about how it's his hands that mold us and we need to be moldable, right? We need to be receptive to whatever he has to give us. Another example is like a jar or a pot or my big, huge, fancy water bottle that Jenny got me the other day since I broke my lid. It's receptive to water. My hand, not as receptive to water. Maybe a little, but not as much as my water bottle because that's what it was made for, right? It was made to receive liquid. And clay was made to receive a shape that was made by another person's hands. Like I said, receiving things, there's something active to it. Just as much as we can be open and willing and ready to receive God, we can be just as stubborn, unmoving, and unwilling to listen to God and to listen to what he has to say to us and receive what he wants us to have. As much as we can be receptive, we can also be stubborn and closed off. One example that
I think about a lot in my life. My spiritual director is a Franciscan. His name is Father Rick. He was just at Ave Maria University. He's going up to Indiana, actually, to now be their campus minister. But he told me a story once about his aunt. His aunt, for as long as he could remember, his aunt had fallen away from her faith. She was a bit older than he was. And he said that ever since he could remember, they always prayed for his aunt. You know, when everyone was asking for intentions, they always, always prayed for this one aunt that he had. And years and years and years of prayers. And it almost made him discouraged after a while, because he was like, we've been praying all this time for my aunt, and the Lord still, like, she's still not converting. She still, like, doesn't want to go to Mass. Like, she still doesn't want to receive the gifts of the Lord. So one day, this aunt actually got into a fatal car accident. She got into a car accident. She was rushed to the hospital. And she was laying there knowing that her days were numbered, that her time was running out. And in those moments when she knew she was close to death, she cried out and said, God, if you're there, like, help me, be with me. For the few short days that she lived after that, she was more on fire for her faith than, according to my spiritual director, Father Rick, anyone he had ever met. She was praying rosaries. She was receiving the Eucharist as often as she could. She received extreme unction or anointing of the sick, last rites. She went to confession. Her whole life changed. And he said that he came to this realization that the graces and the gifts that our Lord wants to give us are never, ever wasted. He said the problem was she, within herself, had built up this dam. She built up this wall. She said, God, I don't want you. God, I don't need you. I don't care about you. I don't believe in you. Whatever it is. She tried to block out all of these graces. And even though her family and her loved ones and her friends were all praying for her to turn her heart towards Christ, she had this wall up and said, no, I don't want it. Like I said before, Jesus is a gentleman. He's not going to force himself on anyone. But he said what had happened was all of those prayers were just building and building and building, like water behind a dam, increasing and increasing, just waiting. All of that grace was just waiting for one moment, for one second, for one little crack in the wall. And the minute she cried out to God, every grace from every prayer, from every fasting and every rosary and mass could just come pouring over her soul and made her more on fire than ever. And maybe we have people in our lives that are like that, that for some reason just have this wall. Or maybe you're starting to build a wall up in your own heart, saying, this Jesus stuff, not for me. I don't care about it. I don't want it. And we want to start building up a wall, building up a dam, and saying, nope, I don't want it. That's why it's one of the greatest callings that we have as Christians to receive. We can put up walls in our heart that block out God's love for us and what he wants to give us and what he wants to do for us. And these gifts and these graces can be in the good, in the bad, in the ugly. Just like Father Rick's aunt's car accident. Probably, anyone would say, would be the worst thing that ever happened to her. Before she died, she said it was the best thing that ever happened to her. Because it allowed her to open herself up to all of the love that the Lord had been wanting to give her for so long. And he wants to give you that love too. Like I said, receiving is not something you just sit back and watch happen. You ask for it. You be open to it. You ask for the Lord's guidance and what to do with the gifts and the things that he's given you. And you don't push him out. You don't build up walls against our Lord. Tear them all down and receive what he wants to give you. And also, just in the same way that God is the source of all life and our life comes from him, right? Like the sunflower image. The same thing is true with love. We actually can't love except through God. He is the source of all love, and all love comes from him. So if we want to love ourselves, our friends, our family, even God himself, if we want to love anyone truly, we have to receive that from God. That comes from him and him alone. So it's important for us to receive his love and not build up walls thinking, God can't love me, he can't move in me, he can't do something with my life. We have to receive and know that he loves us so that we can then go out and love others. If it's true that You must love your neighbor as you love yourself, right? That means you have to love yourself. Or you can't love anybody else. And you'll only find that in letting our Lord love you. Can we go to the next slide, please? Another reason why we need to receive gifts from our Lord is because our gifts are never, ever, ever just for us. There may be a part of it that's just for you, like something like sweet that our Lord just wants to show you how much he loves you. But if you look in scripture, right, you look at, like, say, the disciples after Pentecost, when all the gifts of the Holy Spirit come down upon them, the first thing they do is go out and preach and proclaim the word of God. And they speak in multiple tongues, which brings a ton of people to believe, right, in the Lord. I think about people who are here at this camp, right? They have gifts. Your servants, your shepherds, myself, Abraham, the directors. We're all so different. And we all have such important gifts that make this camp what it is for each of you. There was a long time where I didn't think that I could ever do this, if I'm being honest. There's a lot of times where I still don't think I can do this. But I know that our Lord has given me a gift. And if I didn't say yes to that gift that he gave me and say, I'm going to use this gift I have for talking to people about Jesus and use it to inspire other people so that they can talk about Jesus, then I wouldn't be here. Your gifts are never, ever, ever just for you. So if you don't accept them, if you don't receive them, if you don't ask the Lord, what do you want me to do with these? that could be one more person that you were supposed to help get to Christ. This is why when you guys are like in your small group sessions, your shepherds will try and be like, you know, we really want you guys to like talk to each other and answer questions. What is the Lord saying to you in this scripture, right? What is the Lord said? What stuck out to you during that talk? Because some story that you have or something that you thought was cool could really mean a lot to somebody else in your small group. The gifts that you're given are never just for you. So you have to receive them. Because these gifts just keep on giving. The Lord is so, so generous to us. Go to the next slide, please. So like I said, the past couple days I've been saying, these talks really kind of follow the order of the Mass. So we have like the Liturgy of the Eucharist, then we have our prayers of thanksgiving for the Lord. And now we're at the part where we receive, right? It's perfect that this is right in the middle of our week because that's the highest point of the Mass. So what have I been saying? And I'll say it before and I'll say it again a million times until I can't speak anymore. The most important thing that you can do with your life is receive Jesus. If you ever, ever, ever want to be Christ to anyone else, what better thing can you do than receive him? And what amazing love this is to receive. Our God, who came over 2,000 years ago, said, it's not enough that I just die for you. It's not even enough that I just rise for you. I also want to create a way that I can be as close to you as humanly possible until I can be with you forever. The most beautiful gift of love that we can possibly receive is the Eucharist. In the Eucharist, Jesus is giving us his entire self, body, blood, soul, and divinity. And again, through this gift is how we can be Christ to the world, how our faith can become alive. There is no better gift you can possibly receive. There's no better use of your time than to spend it with our Lord. He is the source of all life, and if we are called to be alive in Christ Jesus, look no further than the Eucharist. Go to the next slide, please. This is a quote from St. Dominic Savio, our patron of our camp, who died when he was around your guys' age, but had faith that is indescribable even to me, who said this about receiving the Eucharist. He said, I need nothing in this world in order to be happy. I only need to see Jesus in heaven, whom I now see and adore on the altar with the eyes of faith. You hear these crazy stories about saints like St. Maximilian Kolbe or some of the desert fathers who like lived essentially only on the Eucharist for days and days and days at a time, right? The greatest possible gift we can receive. You get to receive God and have him be alive within you. The truth that Dominic Savio understood very, very well. It is heaven on earth. The greatest gift that we can receive. I want to end this talk with a prayer that I kind of just made up after reading scripture. And for me, serves as a good reminder of a couple of important things. One, I want to tell you that if you ever want a sneaky peek into Hannah's brain right before she gets up from kneeling, it's almost always this. Almost always. It's almost the first thing that comes to my mind right as I finish prayer. And it reminds me of a couple things. It first reminds me of how important Christ is, right? And I get that from scripture, of Christ being the greatest love of my life and the greatest desire of my heart. So even if I am not doing well, maybe I haven't been to confession in a long time, or maybe I haven't sinned in, or maybe I haven't been prioritizing or focusing on God, when I say this, I remember He is the most important thing in my life, even if I haven't been acting like it. The second thing that it reminds me is how important it is for me to strive to love Him more. The beauty of receiving love from Christ, the beauty of love in general, love is a gift that we can receive and that we can give, and it never gets less. But you know how you give someone a cake, there's only so many pieces of cake. And if I give you a piece of cake, I'm not going to have as much cake for myself at the end. But love isn't like that. Love, the more you give, the more it grows, the more you have. It grows in sharing. And how much more is that true when we're giving love to love Himself? It's like a well that has no bottom. You can never love the Lord too much. You'll never hit the level of, yep, this is about as much as you can love Jesus. That's about it. You've peaked. You did it, right? No matter how much you're doing, there's always more. He always wants to give you more. He's always calling you to more. And the last thing that it reminds me of is that I can only do any of that. I can only love Him more if He first loves me. And the thing is, like I was saying before, it's not about whether or not God loves me. That's not the question. That's not why the end says, and be loved by you more. God can't possibly love me anymore. He is love, and He loves me with everything that He is. He gives me everything. So that line doesn't say anything about who God is, but says a lot about who I am. The only way that we can love is if God first loves us. And again, I can do the same thing that any of us can do and build up walls and block out God's love and say, you can't love me. You can't give me these gifts. I don't deserve it. I shouldn't have it. So I have to let myself be loved by our Lord. We all have to let Him love us. It's only in receiving His love that we can then be loved to the rest of the world. Would you all join me? I'd like to end in this prayer. And then Abraham will lead us in a little prayer through song. So if you all stand up, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear Jesus, you are the greatest love of my life and desire of my heart. Help me to love you more and be loved by you.
We're going to try the chorus of a new song this evening. It goes like this. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Let's try that together.
I run into the Father, I fall into grace, I'm done with the hiding.
Yeah.
My heart needs a surgeon, so I run to the Father again and again and again and again.
Let's go.
Oh, oh, oh. I've carried a burden for too long a night. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go, and I see it now. I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I'm running to the Father, I fall into grace, I'm done with the hiding, the reason's away. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again. And again and again, oh, 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 oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, my heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, and so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. We sing, oh, my heart has been in your sights long before my first breath, running into your arms is running to life from death. And I feel this rush deep in my chest, mercy is calling out. And just as I am, you pull me in, and I know I need you now. My heart has been in long before my first breath, running into your arms, running to life from death. And I feel this rush deep in my chest, just as I am. And I know I need you now. I run to the Father, I fall into grace, a reason to wait. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend, so I'll run to. Oh, again and again. Oh.
My heart has been in this rush, and mercy is come, and just as I am, and I know I run to the Father with all its grace, and turn with. My soul found a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, again and again. Oh.
Let's pray the St. Dominic Savio prayer. Everyone must do what he can.
I am not able to do great things. What I can, I want to do with greater power than God. I offer him my mere deeds.
Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all the people said,
Amen.